okay on that question, then we can move on to the next one about atropine research, if you're okay with that, Dr. Sabag.
I am. This is another example of a productive interaction between you guys and me. I, of course, knew about atropine, but I never really considered it worthy of attention until I was encouraged by Bruna and I think Matt to look into it further. And like anything else, the question has become broader, meaning it's not just a question of does atropine help people or not? The question becomes, what is the relationship between pupil diameter, floaters, and vision-degrading myodysopsia? And so by broadening that question, it's become of scientific interest and more complex, meaning in addition to evaluating whether atropine works or not, we need to get an understanding of the correlation between pupil diameter and symptomatology and contrast sensitivity function. Obviously, there should be no effect on vitreous structure by the pupil diameter. It's simply a matter of the consequence of a given vitreous structure. Might that vary with different pupil diameters? So when the problem became larger like this, we took a step back and started to design a protocol that tested pupil diameter. And we're looking at various instruments that measure pupil diameter using infrared light to not influence the diameter with any illumination. And we're looking at different instruments and trying to figure out which one would be best for our purposes. And then design a protocol where we correlate pupil diameter, and then we administer atropine for a month, and then have the patients come back and repeat all of the testing protocol. And we need to submit an IRB for that, even though it's approved, as you pointed out, for the treatment of pediatric myopia. You know, I'm a pretty careful person, and we're dealing in a controversial area. And I think that we need to take proper precautions to make sure it's approved. And I think it will be approved, but these things all take months to occur. But thanks to you guys, I have a different perspective on the issue because, for example, in the past, many people have told me that they no longer go camping, they no longer go fishing, they no longer enjoy skiing. Bright light situations have become miserable experiences in their lives. And I always thought it's because if there's more light, there's more scattering, there's more VDM. But an alternate hypothesis is that with more light, the pupil is smaller. And with a smaller pupil, the symptoms that result from existing vitreous opacities are more bothersome. And that's the reason why atropine works. But it doesn't work in everybody. I don't really know why it doesn't work in everybody, but we have to start with the basics and get an understanding of the relationship between pupil diameter, symptoms, contrast sensitivity function. And we're also gearing up to measure reading speed and accuracy. We've purchased equipment, and I have an associate who has taken over the project of setting up the measure of reading speed and accuracy as another index of how floaters impact vision. So that's going to be incorporated in all of our studies once it's up and running. But I hope you can appreciate that although it delays somewhat attempts to answer the question of whether atropine works or not, I think it broadens the topic appropriately and makes it more scientific and provides more information that I think will be useful to all of us.